Good afternoon. You're listening to Education Today on KPFA 94.1 FM, and I'm your host, Kitty Kelly Epstein. Today we have the opportunity to talk with two dynamic women who are struggling for justice in communities that are very close in some ways and at the same time very distant from each other. Kimberly Mayfield is the deputy mayor of Oakland. She holds a bachelor's degree from the University of California, Santa Barbara, and a doctorate from the University of San Francisco. And she has worked as a public school teacher, a university professor, and a university administrator before joining city government. Among other projects, she is working to ensure that Black and Brown communities are fully represented in the decision-making and the policies of the city. And Dr. Mayfield is my longtime, beloved, and greatly respected friend. Welcome to Education Today.
Thank you, Dr. Epstein.
Danielle Obono is a member of the French Parliament, which is the legislative body of France's government, similar perhaps to the Congress. She identifies as an Afrofeminist and an eco-socialist. She holds a master's degree in history, and she was in the process of earning a doctorate when she was elected to the French Parliament as a representative from Paris. She has taken many anti-racist and internationalist positions, which have helped to shape a new conversation within the French government. She recently became a member of the Court of Justice of the Republic, and she is my new international heroine, one of the people I most respect in the world for the positions that she has taken in France. Deputy Obono, there is no way I can convey how honored we are to have you join us. I think we in the U.S. have a lot to learn from your courage and from your politics. And so,
thank you so much for having me.
Sure. And so I wonder what else we need to know about you besides what I put in the introduction.
Oh, I think you make a great introduction about me. And maybe I'll tell you more throughout the conversation. But maybe I could add, first and foremost, I'm an activist. And I've been an activist for the past 20 years now, an activist for social justice, anti-racist, anti-war. And yeah, I think that's how I will define myself. And being part of the National Assembly is part of this this fight and struggle for social justice that has been involved over the past 20 years now.
We have, as you may know, many activists in the Bay Area, and that's one of the reasons that I think people will be so interested to hear your thoughts on many issues. And, of course, Dr. Mayfield is also an activist, and the station is kind of devoted to that. So we really appreciate you identifying in that way. And speaking of activists, something that's on the hearts and souls and spirits of many of us right now is what's happening in Gaza. And I wonder if you could share with us any of your thinking about that.
Oh, yeah, I think it's all over the world. People are just sympathizing with the people in Israel and Gaza. And everybody is really feeling the sufferings that are happening over there. Of course, we all do feel very deeply about the people being slaughtered on October 7th and all the people who have been killed since then in Gaza, but also in the West Bank. I think the common thought and what has been mobilizing a lot of people all around the world, and that we are just needs to keep shouting is ceasefire now. And I think I've watched London, Washington, even Paris, in Barcelona, all over the world, people are just right now mobilizing for a ceasefire now, and it's very, very important that we succeed in obtaining this ceasefire, and that should be the start of conversations in our countries, especially Western countries. I think shamefully, our governments in Western country haven't had the stand that they should have had, and haven't contributed right now to the ceasefire that is needed, and the get back to talking about what has been happening in Israel and Palestine for the past 75 years, and the actual war that is happening now is part of this this long-term situation, which is a colonization process, which is the situation of Palestinian people, and we need to get to the roots of that. We also need to understand and to have this conversation, because that's the only way we can really address the situation. Right now, we need a ceasefire. We need help to be delivered to the people of Gaza, who are now entering, I think it's been 2 weeks now, that over 7,000 people have been killed. I think it's about two-thirds, maybe more, are women and children. And this is something we can't just, you know, watch on social media and let happen and let keep happening. So we need to push our government to take a vocal stand for a ceasefire and support to the Palestinian people. And I think also it's part of the process that will make the people in Israel safer. And I think it will benefit both people. So I think in this moment, it's very frightening. And we're watching people dying. We've watched people being slaughtered on October 7th. We've watched all the videos of kids, women and men being killed by the Israeli army in Gaza, people in the West Bank also, and this needs to stop. And right now I'm most inspired by the people who are demonstrating in the US, but also in Israel. People are now demonstrating to say this needs to stop. The hostage need to be freed, and we need to think about seriously about resolving this war and stop the colonization and stop what is at the roots of the present war.
Thank you. Dr. Mayfield, what are your thoughts about this?
Very similar to the deputies, this is probably unexpectedly a human issue that has captured the hearts and minds globally. I think in much the way the televising of the attack on Black people during the civil rights movement. And it's probably the first time that people my age, like born after the civil rights movement, have bared witness to this kind of genocide. And so I think the organizing globally is what's needed and is building the momentum, I believe, for a lot of Americans and a lot of young people. It's a teachable moment. A lot of younger people, like in their 30s, they didn't grow up with, you know, there needs to be peace in the Middle East. Like, I grew up hearing that in the 70s and 80s, and I think that now is the time for us to move forward so that we're able to do, as the deputy said, call for a ceasefire to see women and children and the bombing of hospitals is very unsettling, and it is hitting people at a core level that I don't know that other movements in recent history have done.
And I wonder if the fact that there are these protests all over the world, literally, may lead to the possibility of a stronger international movement on this and other issues, because that hasn't really been the case that much. I mean, really, totally international everywhere. Mm-hmm. So you two had the chance to talk in Paris when Kimberly visited there recently. And I want to give a shout out to Zaire Meliani for many things, but one of them being providing this opportunity for you guys to talk to each other and a lot of things like that. I appreciate that he did that. And so I wanted to ask you if you two have found, either in your conversations or separately, that there are ways that people in the U.S. and in France should and can be working together on some of these issues, either our local issues or these international issues. Either one of you have a thought about that?
Yeah, I can.
Please,
I can
go ahead.
First, I was so pleased and inspired to meet you guys in Paris. I've read about the history of social struggles, anti-racist struggles in Auckland, and it was very inspiring for me as a young activist to read about the, you know, civil rights movements, the revolutionary also black activists over there. So it was so really inspiring for me to meet you guys, and also to learn more about what you've been doing over there. And also to learn about what it is to be in a position of power on the local level and trying to implement policies that try to make a difference for everyday lives. And I think it was very interesting to see how you get people together and make a difference for people. I think one of them, how do we learn the lessons is very important for us, because here in France we also, I mean, I'm a member of the National Assembly, but we're very interested in knowing also, because with my movement, we want to take power, we want to rule this country and to change things, and it also needs to start at the local levels. And so to know how things are done over there, how could we learn from you over there, is very, very important, because you can't just think, you know, from the top. It really needs to come from the bottom up, you know, and I think this is a very process. We're very keen on what we called revolution citoyenne, which means like a citizen's revolution coming from, you know, from below, from the rank and file, from the ordinary working people. And I think, you know, so what you've been doing over there to mobilize people and you know, win the elections and keep implementing policies is very, yeah, inspiring. And I learned a lot about that.
That's wonderful. A citizens' revolution, yeah. We'd like that too. Kimberly, thoughts?
One of the things that I learned a lot about on this recent trip is really the daily struggle that immigrants have. And it made me think about what immigrants to the United States and Oakland, California and Oakland specifically might be encountering, that is not just really transparent. So having a lot of conversations, was really helpful in illuminating that, especially the current struggle that the Muslim people in France are having. Mm. But in our conversations with the deputy, I think we were really inspired by your conviction and courage to really speak truth to power. And we have examples of what that looks like in the context of the United States, but to see it in a global context, in a country where people of African descent cannot gather because it would be seen as separatist and sort of against the government, was really inspiring. And I think that there are lots of things for us to learn tactically from those that are in the assembly, like the deputy.
And I think not all Americans actually know that that's the case. Deputy Obono, you want to say anything about that, about these kinds of restrictions, both the Islamophobia and also the restrictions on people, you know, the whole idea that everybody's the same, except everybody's not the same,
right?
Because everybody doesn't get the same stuff. So any other thoughts about that?
Yeah, because, I mean, it's always interesting because here in France, the United States are always depicted of this country where there's racism and it's very bad and, you know, in a way to position us as a bit, you know, more evolved and better. And but when it comes to actually discussing this, the very situation in France, because France used to be an empire. We enslaved people in Africa. We colonized half of the world. And so structural racism is very much a French reality. But we never, you know, it's very difficult to have this conversation because we have this ideal about the Republic being, you know, kind of colorblind and that everybody is equal, which is, I mean, I wholeheartedly believe in that, in those ideas and principles of our Republic, which is freedom, equality, and fraternity. Of course, those are very powerful words, and people actually fought for their life and managed to build this. And it's, I mean, those are working class and ordinary people conquests that we managed to get. But at the same time, we are on the institutional level, there is institutional racism in our country against people of black descent, whether they are like from the French West Indies or from Africa, like myself, whether it's from institutional racism against black and brown young men who faced police brutality and systemic, you know, police racism and violence, whether it's people of Muslim faith, and there's especially, that's been the focus of, you know, a lot of attacks against people of Muslim faith, and Islamophobia is one of the worst right now in France. And also anti-migrant policies, and we will in the next few weeks debate yet again another bill about, you know, against migrants. So you got all those issues, and it's very hard to have a conversation about race in France. And at the same time, as I said, I've been involved in activism, in political activism for a long time now. And I also felt there's been a change over the past years where, you know, young people have been more and more vocal about those issues. Black and brown people from African backgrounds and Arabic backgrounds, they've been, you know, actually speaking out about it. You get a few other people in the media, like maybe you've heard about her, Rokaya Diallo, who's a journalist, and she's great because she's one of the brightest voice and strongest voice right now. And so yes, because of people fighting back, because of people organizing against police brutality, you have movements demanding justice for all those black people and Arab people being killed by the police, and you got a movement like Justice pour Adama, which is led by Assa Traoré. You may have heard about her, and she was front page in one of the Times magazine issue a couple of years ago, and she's the sister of a young black man who's been killed by the police, and you go, so those movements managed to, you know, give a voice to those feelings and the reality of inequalities in France. So that's very inspiring for me. And nowadays, you know, I've been elected in 2017, and I was one of the only, you know, black women elected on, you know, from the radical left. And nowadays there's more of us since 2022. One of my colleagues, I want to talk about her because she's so inspiring. Her name is Rachel Keke. She used to be a cleaner, and she was in for 22 months. She led a strike to demand better working conditions and against also so the sexism and racism she faced. And she and her colleagues won this fight, and now she became an MP, and she's really like she's a hero of mine because she's so great and inspiring for a lot of people. So yeah, I would say that there's still so much to do here, but there are more and more of us, you know, fighting back and you know, speaking up, and some of us even managed to, you know, get elected. Not enough. There's a lot of work to do, even within, you know, the political movements, because there's still, you know, racism even within the left spaces. And yeah, we have to fight for everything still. But there's more of us, and we're still and we definitely are fighting back against that. And that's, yeah, that's what I would say about the situation here.
So I've noticed, I am really impressed by what you've accomplished. I have been watching now French politics for a few years, and as friends pointed out to me, the white left in France seemed to be extremely racist and unresponsive to issues around race and Islamophobia and so on. And it seems that you all have accomplished a lot. You mentioned Rachel Keke. That's such a beautiful story of her being able to be in the parliament, a working class woman, inspiring for everyone. And but you also have actually changed a lot of the white leftists, not enough, but some of them, to actually embrace the causes and positions that you all are taking, which I find very inspiring myself. And I know, Kimberly, I think that's an issue here also, is to get white people who consider themselves progressive to actually be progressive on some issues. Is that correct?
That is correct.
And you find that also?
Yeah, they think they're progressive, but then they're not very reflective of the racial aspect of everything that's happening. And they think that progressivism will take care of the racism. But if we don't address it intentionally, it just continues to, operate.
We have a few more minutes. About just a few more minutes. But I wanted to be sure that people are able to find you too, if they so we want to invite Daniela Bono to come to Oakland. We would throw you a big everything.
yes
parties,
speeches.
KPFA would love to have you on again. I know So please, if all you right. can find your way here, we yeah. promise to show you a very good time.
Oh yeah, I would love to. Let's do it. Let's do it. Like it's date. Let's do it.
Yeah, I would love to have this conversation with hundreds of people in some auditorium
yes.
where we could talk at length about all these issues and how we can help each other and learn from each other's struggles. And so before we get to do that, though, Danielle, could you tell us what how people can find you, what you're doing? I know you have a Twitter feed and maybe some other ways that, and you've written some articles, and as our audience can tell, you write in French, but you also write in English, which is in, or get interviewed in English, so they can continue to read about what you're doing. You want to tell us how they can find you?
So I mean, obviously it's in French, but you got my social media, especially X, former Twitter. I'm quite active on it, and on Facebook. My ex account is Deputy Obono. It's DEPUTEE_OBONO. So mostly in French. I'm sorry for that. But I've given a few interviews to Jacobin magazine in English. So there's a couple of them where the most recent one dates back September. This year, and I was talking especially about what's been happening about the movement against structural racism in France. So I would strongly advise you to read this, and you'll see the other articles, interview I gave to Jacobin magazine, which is really great, a great magazine. And I would say you can follow me on Facebook, Instagram. It's the same. It's a same name, Deputy Obono. If you write it down,
And there's a Wikipedia page also, which I consulted myself, which has some more of the deputy's history. Dr. Mayfield, can you tell us how people find you and your social media or wherever else?
Yes. I have an Instagram account, Kimberly Mayfield, DMO, and I can be found there. Please follow me on Instagram.
Thank you. So I want to say to our guests, it's been an amazing opportunity to talk with you, and especially to talk with you both together, and I've learned so much, and I want to thank our engineer, Rod Akeel, and you've been listening to Education Today on KPFA 94.1 FM. I'm your host, Kitty Kelly Epstein. My co-host is Jaron Epstein, and he'll be with us again next week. So see you every Wednesday at 2:30 on the afternoon Pacific time. Thank you again, Danielle and Kimberly, for being with us, and we'll look forward to talking with you again soon. Bye-bye.
Palestinian-American human rights attorney Nora Erekat.
There has been a priming that all of these mass atrocities will be accepted by a population who will watch it with lament, but think to themselves, but what else was Israel supposed to do? We are all being primed to accept mass atrocities. This historically is the playbook of how genocides happen. What we are seeing is a genocidal campaign. You cannot forcibly transfer 1.1 million Palestinians in a 225 square mile enclosed area. There is nowhere for them to go.
Storytelling for social change on KPFA.
You're listening to 94.1 KPFA, 89.3 KPFB in Berkeley, 88.1 KFCF in Fresno, 97.5 K24 8BR in Santa Cruz, and online worldwide at kpfa.org.